Thanks to Surfshark for sponsoring today's video. In 2012, the Dawn spacecraft completed a 14-month survey around the giant 500-kilometer-wide asteroid, Vesta. But its mission wasn't finished yet. The second and perhaps most interesting leg of its mission was coming up, a detailed survey around the dwarf planet Ceres. You see, Dawn was to be the first mission ever to go into orbit around two different extraterrestrial objects. It could do this because it was a rather unusual spacecraft, equipped with three ion engines. These engines don't produce a lot of thrust in one go like a rocket, but rather, they can very efficiently run for years at a time. Over the course of Dawn's mission, these thrusters provided a velocity change of 11.5 kilometers a second, meaning Dawn could enter into quite a tight orbit around Vesta, do detailed surveys there, escape Vesta's gravity, and head on over to Ceres. The anticipation within the scientific community to reach Ceres was palpable. Even with the aid of the Hubble Space Telescope, the best image we had of Ceres was this. It was still a mysterious body. What was lying in wait there? Would Dawn hold up to years in the unforgiving environment of space? And what would Ceres reveal about our own solar system? I'm Alex McColgan, and you're watching Astrum, and together we will explore the surface of Ceres and find out what the Dawn spacecraft saw and discovered there. After 2 years in transit between the two bodies, Dawn finally began the approach to Ceres. As days passed, the resolution of Ceres got better and better. Details like craters could finally be resolved, and most interestingly of all, bright white dots could be seen. I remember at the time that as these images were coming in, speculation was rife about what they could be. As higher resolution images were received, it looked like the bright spots were actually two separate spots. And then the increased resolution revealed it was in fact several different spots. Dawn also observed the scarred nature of Ceres up close, with craters littering the surface. Although there aren't as many craters here as previously expected. Taking this into consideration, and the bright spots I already mentioned, it became clear that Ceres is not as inactive and inert as we may have previously thought. Before we delve deeper into that, let's first give you some context. Ceres is a very unusual body, seemingly out of place in the asteroid belt. Most asteroids are mainly composed of non-volatile substances, mainly rocks and metals. Ceres, on the other hand, has a similar composition to that of a comet. It is, in other words, an icy world. However, being this close to the Sun, any ice directly on the surface sublimates. This means that the surface crust is rocky, yet porous, with water locked into the gaps, with a ratio of about 90% rocks and 10% water. Beneath the surface, there is believed to be a muddy mantle, and a large core of hydrated rocks, such as clays, where rock and brine are mixed together at a 50-50 ratio, although this has been hard to confirm. Other models suggest the core could be a lot drier and smaller, with a greater ratio of water to be found in the mantle. Either way, water is definitely present in Ceres in large quantities, making up perhaps 50% of its total volume due to Ceres' low density. And it's this water that perhaps renews the surface of Ceres, albeit over extremely long timescales. You see, these bright spots are what is known as cryovolcanoes. Unlike regular volcanoes, which spew lava out from the mantle, cryovolcanoes erupt water. This is a 3D model based on Dawn data of the biggest bright spot on Ceres. Water on Ceres is packed full of salt, meaning that when a cryovolcano on Ceres erupts, the water sublimates, and the salt is left behind. This was directly observed over the brightest patch on Ceres, known as Spot 5, as a haze was periodically seen over this area, indicating that water there had sublimated. These bright spots darken over time from exposure to the sun through space weathering, so it's likely that many old cryovolcanoes exist on the surface of Ceres, although we can now only see the most active and recent ones. However, the ones we see aren't just limited to the bright spots we've looked at so far. There are many of them dotted around the dwarf planet. Water was discovered in other regions around Ceres too. Due to Ceres' very minimal axial tilt of only 4 degrees, some craters at its poles are in perpetual darkness. The bottom of these craters never see direct sunlight, meaning water ice can exist here without sublimating. This is very similar to our moon, where water ice is thought to have been trapped at the bottom of perpetually dark craters for billions of years. What else did Dawn spot on the surface of Ceres? As I mentioned, it saw plenty of craters, each with unique characteristics. Some were very round and defined. Others had scarps along the crater floor. There are plenty of examples of complex craters with tall peaks in the center. There was even evidence of crater rims collapsing. For example, this rock having fallen away from the crater walls. Smaller rocks were also spotted having fallen down crater walls, evidenced by the trails they left behind. I also love these photos taken at an angle, pointed along the limb of the dwarf planet. To me, these give a much better idea of the scale of the features we are looking at. Although, without an atmosphere to provide a sense of depth, it is hard to judge sizes in images like these. Fractures were also spotted all over Ceres, indicating there have been stresses in the crust. Some of them are relatively young, perhaps only a few hundred million years old. Some of them come in the form of grooves and troughs, where the crust has been stretched, and other fractures can be seen in the form of rows of mountains, where the crust has been compressed. One particularly unusual feature was spotted on Ceres, called Ahuna Mons. It's a mountain about 20 kilometers wide and 5 kilometers high, but what's unusual about it is how it just sticks up from the surrounding area with no apparent cause. It would be less unusual if there were other features like this on Ceres, because then it could be said it's a global phenomenon, but it's the only thing like it on the entire world. The best bet we currently have is that it is an old cryovolcano, formed because of a large impact directly on the other side of the dwarf planet. Seismic waves from a large impact can propagate through the crust of a planet, and where the waves meet again on the opposite side is known as the antipode. Known antipodal regions around the solar system tend to have some kind of weird terrain, like that found on Mercury. Ahuna Mons could fit this description, with seismic waves from an impact on the opposite side of Ceres triggering volcanic activity here. In 2017, Dawn concluded its mission, having been a tremendous success. It finally ran out of propellant, which means it can no longer stay pointed at Earth to send back data or receive commands. It's been left in a stable orbit around Ceres, a monument in space that will remain there for at least another 20 years. Perhaps more missions will utilize ion engines going forward after the success of this one, but in the meantime, Dawn's discoveries and data will be at the heart of asteroid research for many years yet. Thanks to Surfshark for sponsoring today's video. For those of you that don't know, a VPN is a virtual private network, which allows you to securely surf the web as if you were anywhere on Earth. Sadly, they haven't got servers for Ceres just yet. But for me, this is super useful, as although I'm British, I live most of the time in Switzerland, and it's highly annoying for me when I go on Netflix and they region lock the English audio tracks out of the shows or films I want and only give German as an option, or completely region lock shows from being viewed at all. With Surfshark, I can connect to a UK server and enjoy watching exactly what I want. Are you ever using a public connection and are concerned it's not secure? Turn on Surfshark and your data is now encrypted. You can use passwords, send pictures, and private messages risk-free. Surfshark is the only VPN to offer one account to use on unlimited number of devices, so use my code to get 83% off and 3 extra months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. Link is in the description below. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, check out the other one I made about Vesta during the first leg of this mission. Want to support Astrum? Check the links in the description to become a patron or a member. All the best, and see you next time.